Good morning, everyone. Thank you very much for this opportunity to present our recent research. So to start, I come to you from the traditional territory of the Anishinaabe Bewaki, Atiwanderong, Haudenosaunee, Mississauga, and the Mississaugas of the Credit First Nations land. Our research looks at the entry point of female adolescents into sports. So we're looking at examining and addressing constraints to participation among ethnically diverse female adolescents. And my co-investigators, Nick Wadi and Shilpa Dogra, were from Ontario Tech University. So to start, we're gonna be looking, I'm gonna give you a brief research context, which Anne had given me a great segue into female participation in sports, so adolescent participation in sports. I'm going to move on to our research objectives, the methods, key results. This was a mixed methods research, collected a lot of data. So I'm going to give you a little bit of the quantitative and the qualitative results and end with the conclusion and highlights. So to start, we're all well aware that participation in sport is lower among girls than age-matched boys, and that for all genders, participation decreases with age. We also know that adolescence is a critical time period and a difficult time period for many when an individual is developing their likes and dislikes, their behaviors or preferences, and simply putting it, they're learning how to navigate in society. So in relation to sport participation and physical activity, it isn't any different. Adolescence is also a critical developmental period for developing and solidifying the patterns of sport participation. So as I said, Anne gave a great segue into how that drops out during adolescence. So there's a research that documents that within a span of 5 years, for example, between 2005 and 2010, sport participation among females aged 15 to 19 dropped by 13%. And it is different for different ethnic groups, and this is what we're looking to examine. So while many factors have contributed or have been researched and have looked at the decline in sport participation. So for example, self-esteem, perceived physical appearances, recognizing the benefits of sports or not recognizing them, lifestyle, social norms, self-consciousness, weather, either hot or cold climate, demands and lack of opportunities. There was a gap in terms of looking at the interaction of these constraints in different places and for adolescent females in different settings. And so this is what we set out to do. And on a personal note, I do want to talk about where that research interest came from. I had an opportunity to teach at a university in an all-female university in Dubai in 2005. So I was intrigued by the student interest in the topic of sport participation. And so this got me thinking about all the interaction of factors where, you know, that being female came with certain cultural expectations, hot climate, lifestyle meant that, you know, females are expected to do or to carry certain responsibilities in the house and how these things were negotiated in order to either enhance or, you know, limit participation in sports. So that's where that project got created. Eventually, I came to Ontario and realized that it's not any different. We do live in a very cosmopolitan city and there's a lot of ethnic backgrounds. So I felt the need to look at the interaction of these constraints. So we set out for this project. The objectives were to examine interactions of individual, environmental, and task constraints to sports participation among ethnically diverse adolescent females. We looked to identify the combination of constraints that negatively influence sport participation. We're looking at non-participation as opposed to participation among ethnically diverse adolescent girls. We look to gather in-depth knowledge of the sport needs of adolescent girls who are subject to a specific combination of constraints that were identified in step two. And we wanted to provide evidence-based recommendations for the development of programs that have the capacity to increase sport participation among adolescent girls. So there was a multi-step approach to doing this. First, we did a thorough review to identify constraints to sport participation that were identified in the literature. We used Newell's model to classify these constraints into three main components: environmental, individual, or tasks. And so we developed a survey, which was based on 67 identified constraints and demographic characteristics, including age, immigration status, parental education, body type, and employment. And then we use the development assets profile framework to classify common constraints into indices. So we ended up with the following. Within the Newell's model, there were, and within the environmental dimension, there were 7 indices: access, built environment, family support, social support, neighborhood perception, the physical environment and weather, as well as 4 independent constraints. Within the individual domain, there were identity, values, and development, as well as 4 independent constraints, so age, overall health, ethnicity, and body type. And in terms of task constraints, competitiveness, whether the sport required that someone be competitive in it or recreational, the physical intensity requirements, the rules, whether it's co-ed, the contact level between players, long duration, and perseverance. And we modeled, our dependent variable was regular sport participation, which was measured looking at whether the participants were involved in sports for 3 or more times per week. So I'm going to go through the recruitment process. It was a non-probability voluntary sampling method. Anybody that was identified as females between the ages of 13 and 19 were eligible to participate in this research study. We first started through school boards, so which was crazy going through the ethics process for all the different school boards in Ontario, and then private education programs, community organizations, and then we expanded it to social media. And that's where our sample really expanded and it gave us what we're looking for. Quantitative analysis was done using SPSS, using t-tests or chi-squares, as well as unadjusted and adjusted binary logistic regression models. And 3 exploratory bivariate stepwise logistic regression models to determine the most significant constraints to participation in sports. And we use the p-level of less than 0.05. In terms of the qualitative thematic analysis, this was led by 2 researchers, and it consisted of de-identifying and analyzing key themes that emerged from 5 focus groups and 2 one-on-one semi-structured interviews. We ended up with 125 female adolescents for age 13 to 19 who resided in Ontario, Canada. 53% of the participants regularly participated in sports. The average age was 16.8 with a standard deviation of 1.2. They were primarily white. 64% were white. 86% were born in Canada. And the overall median health score was 3.35 out of 5. Looking at the quantitative results, you'll see in that screen, in blue are the constraints related to the environmental dimension. So weather, social support, and family support came out as the most significant. In terms of the individual domain, it was developmental, values, identity, lower age, and competition. And in terms of the task constraints of the sports itself, it was the physical intensity, games of long duration, and perseverance, and these were identified as the constraints to participation. We boiled it down one step further. So in the second step, what came out as the most significant was weather, developmental, and physical intensity. And then we did 2x2 interactions for all the most significant constraints, and we found no significant constraints. In terms of the qualitative analysis, the results were somewhat the same, but the interaction results were a little bit different. So again, in blue, are the constraints related to the environmental dimension. So social support, accessibility, and family environment were the most important. In looking at the individual constraints, it was their perceptions and beliefs about the sports, the experiences that they had throughout growing up with a sport, and the time and energy that they had. And in terms of the task constraints, it was what the sport required in terms of strength, agility, competitiveness, and their development of skills. So qualitatively, analysis revealed an interplay of individual environmental factors that influence sport participation. So mainly whether the participants were comfortable with the sport in terms of the skills that were required, they felt they were good at it, and then therefore their parents really supported them, and all these interacted to ensure or maybe facilitate participation. So to conclude, results highlighted the role of developmental experiences. Previous sport experiences were very important for the participants, them belonging to the sport environment and their attitude towards the sport, as well as their beliefs, and that predicted sport participation for our sample. Although there were a range of constraints, so for example, the physical intensity of the sport, weather, age, perceived competence, perceived skills, self-esteem, their confidence, worries about whether they would embarrass themselves if they played it or not, we saw that task constraints were present and an interplay was evident. So for example, again, participants looked at the intensity of the sport. It requires strength or required skills. They felt that they may not have developed it or had it at a younger age. And so it highlighted the importance of skill development and parental support in developing those skills in order to meet the task requirements of the sport itself. So what that we took from this is that in order to enhance female participation in sports, it is important to target females at a young age with positive experiences that target the self-efficacy, their enjoyment, and their contribution in relation to sports. A lot of the females said that they've sampled different sports, that they didn't really get good at any of them. And therefore, when they became adolescents, it wasn't something that they felt they were good at. And so dropout was one of those things that, you know, was the first thing that they did. Gender messaging that addresses the positive aspects of sport participation is still needed, as well as providing programs that had a range of intensities, physical environments, so cold or indoors and outdoors, as well as social environments such as, and that was a key message of what we saw, leveraging family and peer support. And that was specifically for about 40% of our sample who are newly immigrants, newcomers. So a lot of what we saw yesterday in the sessions and today really highlight that importance as well, the parental support and the social environment that promotes sports participation. Thank you so much for your time. If you have any questions, I'm happy to answer them.
Thanks, Caroline. We have time for one question today. So I think I'll start with, I'm just wondering a bit more about the how. So you had fantastic research. Thank you for sharing those findings and some great takeaways as well. But when we're thinking about people that are programming sports or coaching or leading those sport programs, what can they do based on your findings to really engage teenage girls in their programs and keep them having those positive experiences?
Most of the girls that we spoke to, and specifically I'm focusing on the focus groups and the semi-structured interviews that we've done, tend to talk a lot about the parental support. So working with the parents in terms of ensuring that they have that support to participate in their sports, some of them, you know, of course, like the peer environment as well, who they worked with, their coaches was really important. But what I saw most of it was I wasn't good at it. And therefore, my parents did not want to invest a lot of time or money taking us into there. That also the point of sampling. For some, they did do a bunch of different sports when they were younger, but didn't feel that they were really good at it. They were not able to identify what they, or the parents were not able to help assist in terms of the identification of maybe where their talent was or what they liked, where they were good at, and where they should be developing those skills so that they can retain the participation when they were older. Most of what we're looking at is, so why is it that you don't do it anymore? You've done it. And so why have you stopped at this age? Why is it that you no longer participate in sports? And it tended to focus a lot. There were a few examples of course, peer, my friends are not with me. That really stood out. Like, we don't have friends that participated with us at that age. But I find that if they felt that they were really, really good at it and they developed the atmosphere of belonging within a sport, that was a main predictor in terms of maintaining participation during those adolescent years.
Great. Thank you so much. And a lot of what you said today resonated with my own experiences and relationships with my parents and things like that. So really rang true for me. And thank you for presenting those findings.